kids. I love Christmas time. How many of you love Christmas time? I love celebrating Jesus' birth. I love a lot of the things that go with it. Actually came across something interesting this week. Have you noticed around Christmas time they're coming up with different kinds of lights? It seems like every year. Well, I saw this last week an unusual light show. It's not a Christmas light show, but it happened around Christmas time. And I want to show you a picture of this. This was actually at the celebration of Israel's 70th anniversary, and they did a light show using drones. So let's watch this. It's really cool. Isn't that cool? Did you guys recognize some of those things? There was more to it than that. I just picked some of the things that they did in the sky. They programmed somehow the drones so that they fly into different shapes. Light shows. One of the special things I like about Christmas is all of the colors and lights. How many of you like the colors and lights? I do. People around the world are drawn to... Did you know that people in other countries are drawn to Christmas sometimes just because of the decorations? The festive atmosphere. In fact, some of you may know this, maybe you don't. One church in Bothell, Washington celebrates the colors and lights of Christmas in a very special way every year. And this is actually the person who puts this together is a person who grew up in this town. His name is Caleb Dick. And this is what they do at their church every year at Evergreen Christian Church, Evergreen Church in Bothell, Washington.
We are at Evergreen Church, checking out the awesome Christmas light show.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared.
And they have way more than I even showed you. It's pretty amazing. Every year, literally thousands upon thousands of people in the Seattle area come watch this. And Caleb puts a new one on every year. Pretty amazing, isn't it? The lights of Christmas. At Christmas time, there are Christmas lights of various colors, lighted angels, trees with lights, candles, candlelight services. We see brightly colored packages, ribbons, tinsel of silver and gold. We see decorated cookies of bright colors, gingerbread houses with brightly colored candies, colorful fruit cakes, to name a few. By the way, here's a little side note. When I was called into ministry, maybe I've told you some of this, you know what my biggest fear was? I was going to get fruit cakes for Christmas, and I didn't like them. They didn't make great doorstops. When I was little, I had a fruit cake, and they weren't very good, and so I was like, oh, no, I'm going to get all these fruit cakes. So now you guys are probably going to throw fruit cakes at me just because. Anyway, bright colors and lights are everywhere in decorations of Christmas, aren't they? And it seems appropriate because as we listen and read about the first Christmas, we see it literally shining bright with the glory of God for those present to see. It must have been an amazing sight for the shepherds and the wise men to witness literally the glory of God with their eyes. That's what the scripture says, and we'll read that in a little bit. I'm sure you have actually witnessed the glory of God with your own eyes, even if you don't recognize it. Today we're actually going to look at, and I'll help you maybe recognize some of those things, we're going to look at eyes that saw His glory at the first Christmas, and then we'll look at eyes that see His glory that's revealed for us now and what it means, and where you can see God's glory today all around us. I'm in a series in Christmas on the different parts of the body, and today's is I See His Glory. The song Hark the Herald Angels Sing says this, Gloria in excelsis Deo. You know what that means? That means glory to God in the highest. That's what the angels are singing. I don't know if they were singing it in Latin like that, but or what language. But there's lots of songs. We sang a lot of songs today on the glory of God. And let's start by talking about the first Christmas, eyes that saw His glory. Maybe you can look at the Christmas story a little different today, or as you go through this season, with eyes that see His glory. The first Christmas, they saw His glory. I want to read Isaiah chapter 60. And this is the prediction before Jesus came of what was going to happen when the Messiah came. It starts in Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1. It says this, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples. But the Lord rises upon you, and His glory appears over you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn." That was an anticipation of what Jesus was going to do, and the glory of the Lord was coming, as what we celebrate at Christmas. Let me give you some picture of where it happened at the Christmas story. First, it was all around the angels. Luke chapter 2, verses 9 to 14. Let me read it again if you haven't read it in a while. Here's what it says in that story of Jesus' birth. "An angel of the Lord appeared to them," the shepherds, that is, "and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.' Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom His favor rests.'" This is what I picture it looking like, maybe. The glory of God around the angels. I don't know what you think it looks like. I just found a picture that represented literally the glory of God around the angels was just lighting up the night sky. It was shining around them. We just sang a song today. Angels from the realms of glory wing your flight over all the earth. I can imagine that's what was happening there. It was around the angels, but it wasn't just around the angels. It was also at Jesus' birthplace. Now, I don't know if there was actually light or not, or if it was just the glory of God seen in what was taking place. But in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 5, as it says, the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all mankind together will see it, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. And that's what happened when Jesus was born. The glory of the Lord was revealed through a tiny baby. Have you held a tiny baby in your arms before or looked at a little tiny baby? It's amazing. Yet this baby was even more special than most babies. This was Jesus. And we also see it a little later on in the Christmas story in the night sky. The glory of the Lord shone. The Bible says in Psalm 19:1 this, the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. But this glory that was revealed in the sky at Jesus' birth was more than the normal declaration. Have you ever looked outside at night and just saw the glory of the Lord in the stars? I saw a picture recently where they took and they zoomed in on one little tiny section with the Hubble Space Telescope, and it was literally thousands, and they found thousands of galaxies in one little tiny spot. And each galaxy was bigger than our galaxy. The glory of the Lord was revealing it. But on that Christmas time, the glory of the Lord was revealed even more than just through the stars. In Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, we read the story after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod. Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." There was literally a star shining in the east. Now, whether it was immediately after or a year or 6 months or 3 months later, we don't know for sure. But the other night I was driving home late at night from Forsyth. We had dropped, my mother-in-law and I had dropped our daughter off there so she could go back to college. She was getting a ride with somebody, and so we had to drive back at night. And I saw an extra bright light in this night sky that night. And, of course, I don't know if you've seen one of those really bright lights and you wonder, what is that? I didn't know if it was a plane or a satellite or what it was, so we just kind of kept watching this light. And it never moved as we got closer to Harleton. We were changing direction, so it looked like it might move, but it never moved at all. And so when I got home, I thought, I wonder what that is. Well, I don't know if you've ever seen it, but they have these fancy little apps you can get on your phones that you can point them in the night sky and they'll tell you what they are just by pointing at it. And my wife had downloaded one of those, and so we got home and she said, "Can you tell us what that was?" So she pointed it up in the sky, and it was actually, I guess, Neptune. The planet Neptune was shining bright in the sky that night, brighter than anything else that we could see. It made me wonder about that shining star that the Magi saw. How bright was it? Did people miss it because they weren't looking in the night sky? Or did they actually see that bright light? God was shining literally his glory for the Magi to see and to follow. Isn't that amazing? That picture of the glory of God shining. I mentioned last week I was going to refer to a Christmas song throughout my series. The song is "Do You Hear What I Hear?" I saw his glory in that, and here's what they said. Said the night wind to the little lamb, "Do you see what I see? Way up in the sky, little lamb. Do you see what I see? A star, dancing in the night with a tail as big as a kite." With a tail as big as a kite. Can you imagine? The glory of the Lord shining at Jesus' birth, shining around the angels, shining in the sky, literally. What an amazing sight that must have been. The eyes that saw his glory. Let's move on past the original story and talk about the glory that's revealed for us today. Because the glory of God wasn't just for people 2,000 years ago. It's for us. John 1:14 says, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us." That's talking about Jesus. And it says this, "We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father full of grace and truth." Anybody here seen the glory of God before? I believe it's all around us. We can say the same thing that they said back then. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only. See, the glory is revealed to us because it helps us see the real Jesus. 2 Corinthians 4:4 says, "The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God." God wants his glory to shine, and Satan is trying to stop us. He's trying to keep it. But God reveals his glory so that we can see who the real Jesus is. Hebrews 1:3 says, "The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being." If you've seen Jesus, you've seen God's glory. Matter of fact, there's an actual time when Jesus revealed his glory to his disciples. Do you remember when that was? He went up on a hillside, and he actually transformed in front of them. And it says, when he transformed in front of them, two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor talking with Jesus. And they spoke about his departure, which he was about to bring to fulfillment in Jerusalem. And it says, "Peter and his companions were very sleepy, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men standing with him." Jesus literally glorified in light in front of them. And they saw who he really was. I don't know about you, but that would have been, I don't know what word to say other than awesome. To see his glory in front of me. The glory revealed helps us see the real Jesus. It also shows God's goodness to us. There is an interesting passage. I don't have it all figured out, but it's in Exodus chapter 33. Some of you might know this. Moses in the Old Testament asked if his presence would go with them. And God said his presence would go with him and the Israelite people. And he made this prayer right afterwards. He said this, "Now show me your glory." Let me read the rest of it. "And the Lord said, I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord," or Yahweh, or Jehovah, "in your presence." I don't know how this works, but when he asked to see his glory, you know what God told him he would do? "I will cause my goodness to pass in front of you." I don't know the connection, but there's a connection between God's glory and God's goodness. Somebody said this, "If you don't understand my goodness, then you won't understand my ways." I'd like to say it this way. If you don't understand God's goodness, then you won't understand his glory. Somehow there's a link between the two. God's goodness. Here's another thing that the glory of God reveals to us. It illuminates God's character. It literally does sometimes when the light shows up, like in some of these situations, it illuminates or brings to light who God is. And you know what? Really, it's more than a head knowledge. It's not like, well, I know who God is up here. It's a real world way that you see with your own eyes. You know, notice what I just read in Exodus. He says, "Show me your glory." He says, "I will cause my goodness to pass." And he says, "And I will proclaim my name, Yahweh." That's who he is. That's his character. John 1:14, as I read earlier, it says, "We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." Two more parts of his character, grace and truth. Psalm 115:1 says, "Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory." Why? Because of your love and faithfulness. Two more parts of his character. The glory of God, when it is revealed to us, it helps us see the real Jesus, the real God the Father, the real divine and who he is. And of course, for some, the glory of God reveals this and it guides us. Think of the star in the sky. After the Magi, it says, Matthew 2:9, had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. Sometimes God reveals his glory to us as a guide. Not just as a GPS for travelers, although it kind of seems like that's what happened to the wise men, the Magi, but as a guide for our lives. It points us to Jesus, the Savior. It puts our life on the right path. It becomes a guiding star for us spiritually as well. Here's what I hope that you can experience this Christmas. That the glory of God would be revealed to you and you will go to another level that you've never been before. You will know the real Jesus. You will know God in a way that you never knew him before. His goodness, his character, his life. Let me give you a glimpse of where you can see God's glory around you as you look. You see, here's what I believe. His glory is not meant to be a head knowledge. As in, I know what the glory of God is. I would know it if I saw it. That kind of a thing. I believe it's meant to be known through experiencing the glory of God. You see, when you learn about the glory of God, it can deepen you and challenge you. It can alter your perception and it can correct you. But when you experience the glory of God, it does something totally different. It inspires you. It illuminates you, sometimes literally. It transforms you. If you experience the glory of God, it will personally change you in ways you've never known were possible. Think of the wise men. Think of the shepherds. That's what our world is looking for. You know what they're not looking for? More academic knowledge, more internet knowledge. There's more knowledge in our world today than we've ever seen. What they want now is something real and tangible. They want to experience God. So in the present, here's some ways you where your eyes can see his glory in his creation. Have you seen, some of you have seen the pictures that people are showing around of the sunsets in Montana and the sunrises lately? They're just, wow. The colors, the stuff is amazing. As I read earlier, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the skies proclaim the work of his hands. I personally think you can see God's glory in the rainbow after a storm. Or the sunrise or sunset over the mountains. Or the colors of fall foliage in the fall. I can see the glory of God in pictures. Let me show you some pictures that I see the glory of God in. Let's start with this first set. That says, when it's cold, you can see the song. I love that. Let's show another one. How about the night sky? Those are just some pictures of the night sky. That one on the left is actually from Lake McDonald in Glacier Park. It's in Montana. I think that right one, I'm not sure where it's from, but just looking in the night sky, you can see the glory of God. Let's look at the next one. These are actual, believe it or not, pictures close up of snowflakes. These are not drawn. You've heard that every snowflake is different. They took microscopes or whatever, and they zoomed in on snowflakes. Now, if you can't see the glory of God in that, I can. In a snowflake, one more. I think I have one more. Isaiah 43:7. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I have created for my glory, I have formed him. Yes, I have made him. His greatest creation is you and I. We can see the glory of God in other humans. His creation all around us declares his glory. Stop and smell the roses for a minute and you will see the glory of God all around you. Here's another way you can see the glory of God. In miracles he performs. John 2:11 says, this, the first of his miraculous sign Jesus performed at Cana in Galilee. This is when he turned the water into wine. It says he thus revealed his glory in his disciples put their faith in him. When he did a miracle, it brought out his glory. It was revealed. You can also see it when he does miracles like healing. John 11:4 says, when he heard this, Jesus said, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. And of course, one of the greatest miracles he performed that gave him glory is the story of his friend Lazarus who died. In John 11, it said, as he's telling his friends, as Lazarus is in the tomb, he said, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? And then he rose him from that grave. When God performs supernatural miracles, it brings him glory. How many of you have ever seen God do a miracle? It brings him glory. Tell people about it. You want to know another place it brings God glory? You can look around in the unity of his people. John 17, 22 through 24, I have given them the glory that you have gave me, that they may be one as we are one. Talking about God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. I and them and you and me, may they be brought to complete unity to let the world know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. That glory is revealed in how we respond and act together. Let me ask this question. When we are not in unity, how does that affect the glory we would otherwise give to God? I would say it's less. If we want to give the maximum glory, then we receive the glory and we live it out in unity. The glory of God. Let me give you two more in the present and then a couple more in the future. The glory of God is shown in his presence. Have you noticed when we worship or when we spend time to just sit in his presence, it feels like sometimes like literally the glory of God is in that place? 2 Chronicles 5:14, you see it in the Old Testament in the temple. It says the priests could not perform their service because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the temple of God. When his presence came down, his glory was all over it. Psalm 26:8, I love the house where you live, O Lord, the place where your glory dwells. Where the presence of God is, there's glory. When you are in the presence of God, it's like the glory just falls sometimes. And this one I don't like to say, but I think it's important. And we may have to experience this more and more. But here's another place where the glory of God shines in ways that I don't understand, and that is through persecution. Here's at least my thoughts. We think when we are persecuted that we have done something wrong, or perhaps God is abandoning us, or maybe I sinned. The Bible seems to say something different. 1 Peter 4:14, if you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed. Now listen to what he says. For the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. Think about that. It's almost as if when you are persecuted for Jesus' name's sake, God's glory just goes, I got you. I'm on you. Now, you don't have to pray, God, bring on the persecution so I can get your glory. Because none of us want that. But there will become a time, maybe you have experienced it in your life, maybe you will experience it later, where you will suffer persecution and the glory of God will be there for you. In an unusual way, persecution brings glory to God and surrounds us with his glory. When you stand in the face of persecution and remain faithful to God, God's glory rests on you. Matter of fact, I was thinking that seems to have happened when Stephen was stoned in the book of Acts. It's like all of a sudden he looked up and saw the glory of God as he was being martyred. If seeing is believing, then when you see the glory of God, it does something to us that information cannot do by itself. When you experience, when you see the glory of God, I see his glory. When you see that for yourself, it will do something to you. My prayer for all of us this Christmas is that we will see God's glory as never before. Now let me give you a little point forward to where we can see God's glory in the future. At Jesus' return. Luke 21, at that time, talking about Jesus' return, they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Can you imagine when Jesus comes back, the glory that's going to be revealed, literally in the skies and what's going to happen around us? You see, the Bible says Jesus is coming back for his church. Yes, amen. There's a song that goes like this. You can sing along with me if you know it. There's a blessed time that's coming, coming soon. It may be evening, morning, or at noon. I forgot the words. No, don't go to the chorus. We shall see the King. We shall see the King. You know that one. All right, here we go. There's a blessed time that's coming, coming soon. It may be evening, morning, or at noon. He's coming in the clouds. We'll hail the blessed hour. Something like that. We shall see the King when he comes. Here's how it goes. We shall see the King. We shall see the King. We shall see the King when he comes. He's coming in power. We'll hail the blessed hour. We shall see the King when he comes. Thank you. When Jesus comes, his glory will be revealed to us, and we can sing that song as it happens, maybe. I don't know. Amen? The other time that we will see God's glory, and it will be absolutely amazing, is in heaven. There's a lot of verses that talk about this. Stephen actually looked up and saw the glory of God in heaven. He got a peek into that. Romans 8:18, I consider our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed to us, talking about in heaven. Revelation 21:11, the new Jerusalem shone with the glory of God, and its brilliance was like that of a very precious jewel. It says that there's no sun because the glory of God is the light in heaven. The glory of God will be so amazing, it will literally light up. Someday, we'll get to see the glorious glory there is. But until that day, he has glimpses of his glory all around us. Stop and look and see the glory of God all around you. So let me bring this down to where we live today. What can we do to bring God glory? Number one is this. Receive the good news for yourself. The Bible says this, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. But God made a way by sending Jesus on the cross, first as a little baby at Christmas that we celebrate, and then lived his life, died on a cross, and rose again. So why did he do that? So we might have eternal life, and that we might have a relationship with God. And when we receive that, when we fall short of that glory, what happens is it changes us from the inside out. When we receive the good news, we become a follower of Jesus. We begin to bring God glory by becoming more and more like him. Here's what it says in 2 Corinthians 3:18, and we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. What it's saying is this, when you are a follower of Jesus and you become more and more like him, it's ever-increasing glory it gives to him. So here's the most important decision that we all can make in life and for eternity is to receive the good news into our life, and that would give God the greatest glory. The second thing we can do is this, give 100% to Jesus. Listen to what it says in 1 Corinthians 10:31. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Give 100%. Not, well, a Sunday morning or a Monday night or a Tuesday afternoon. Give it all. Whatever you do, eating, drinking, playing, having fun, whatever you do, give it all for the glory of God. What is God wanting you to do? Do you have an excuse on why you can't do it? Well, I don't want to give that. Then you're not giving 100%. By the way, he will not ask you to do something he knows you can't do with his help. God's grace will never lead you where, or God will never lead you where his grace cannot keep you. Have you heard that saying before? Give 100%. Let me give you a couple ways you can give 100%. In your words and your attitudes. 2 Corinthians 4:15 says, it talks about how when we give thanks, it gives glory to God. Did you know that? Thanksgiving brings glory to God. How many of you would rather be around a person that gives thanks than a person that complains all the time? It gives a lot more glory to God. Here's another way you can give glory to God in giving 100%. In obedience. 2 Peter 1:17. This is talking about Jesus. He received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory saying, "This is my Son whom I love, with whom I am well pleased." Why was God pleased with Jesus? Because he went and got baptized in obedience to the Father. When we are in obedience to the Father, it brings glory. By the way, this is just a side note. Maybe I need to hear it. Maybe you need to hear it. Release the pressure to perform or be perfect. We live for an audience of one, Jesus. I read this recently in a newsletter. It said this: "But as your days and calendars fill with the frantic of the holiday season, release the drive for perfection. Your Christmas service can be disjointed, your message can be boring, and God will still be glorified. Your name can be unrecognizable, and your ministry can still produce fruit. Your work can be small and quiet and unremarkable, and God will still show up in remarkable ways." Now, that was talking to pastors, but in our lives, we don't have to perform. We just have an audience of one. Give 100% to him. And then last but not least, declare his praise. Just like the angels did on the first Christmas, they said glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests. Psalm 96:3 says, "Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples." I get a newsletter from Trinity Bible College, my alma mater, where my daughter's going to school now. This last week they had one from Michael Land, who is the assistant professor of music at Trinity Bible College, and here's what he said. "The rewards of singing in choir," he was talking about, "are to be able to do it all for God's glory and to share this music with others." He says, as the famous composer J.S. Bach would often inscribe his manuscripts, "Solo Deo Gloria," glory to God alone. The angels declared the birth of Jesus and gave him glory. The shepherds told later in that story about what they had seen, and it gave God glory. Creation declares the handiwork of God, and it gives him glory. People receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and it brings God's glory. People sing and make music, and it gives God glory. You see, it's time to see the glory of God around you. Soak it all in, and then let your life declare the glory of God. I'm going to close by playing a video that's got a couple of songs in it. And if you know them, you can sing along. If not, you can just meditate on the words. But these songs are to help us to declare God's glory. The first song is a traditional Christmas song, "Angels We Have Heard on High." The second one, and I don't know why I keep coming back to this person. It was written by Andre Crouch. It's a song called My Tribute to God Be the Glory. As we close today with this song, would you just take a moment and declare glory to God in your heart or with your words as you sing along? So let's just play that in closing today.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo, gloria in gloria.
Just going to invite you all to stand with me. And if you feel comfortable, would you just raise your hand? God, we give you glory today for the things that you have done. I thank you that as we enter this Christmas season and we reflect back on the glory that was revealed during that Christmas time in the star in the sky, in the angels, and in the birth of Jesus, that we can look around us and see the glory of God even today. In your creation, and in the skies, and in the heavens, and even, Lord, as we look into the future and the glory that's to be revealed to us when Jesus returns and when one day we are in heaven. God, I pray that our lives this Christmas would be living testimonies of your glory, that we would strive to give 100% every day to you, Lord. And God, may we experience your glory and your goodness and your character more than we've experienced you in a long time or maybe ever this Christmas season. And may it change us from the inside out. God, I pray if there is one here today or one watching online that has never received you into their life, that right now they would commit 100% and say, Jesus, I want you to be my Lord and my Savior for the glory of God. My Christmas is going to be different this year because I'm all in. I pray that for that person right now in the name of Jesus. And God, we want to be thankful for all that you've done so that we'll give you glory. I pray this in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Amen. May your life reflect God's glory this week.